Happy third week of Advent. Third season of Advent. I'm still waking up. I invite you to stand as we get started this morning. We're going to sing some Christmas carols this morning. We're going to sing It Came Upon a Midnight Clear first.
Yeah. Good morning. I'm Karen Taylor, pastor of Mission and Discipleship, and on behalf of Pastor Trevor, Pastor Steve, and our staff, welcome to this 10 o'clock worship service here at First United Methodist Church. And welcome to those of you who are in the room, those who are watching on Facebook Live or live stream or watching later on YouTube. We're grateful for your presence here with us today. Today, as Paul mentioned, is the third weekend of Advent, and we are expecting Christmas, and we are grateful to be in this time of worship. We do invite you to register your attendance, if you would, whether you're in the room or watching online. Either way, you can register your attendance through our church app. Those of you in the room, there's a Connect card that you can register your attendance, and you can drop it in the offering basket a little later in the service or afterwards. A few announcements to share with you today. During our stewardship series, Way of Generosity, before that began, we invited you to participate in a survey around our discipleship pathway, around the generosity track. And now that that series is completed, we invite you to go back and fill out that survey again to see how you've progressed in your discipleship around generosity. And again, you can do that by going to our First United Methodist Church app and tapping on the Way of Generosity. We're excited to see how you have grown over this time. And so we do, again, invite you to participate in that survey. The next announcement is around our kids' Christmas baking party. So we invite all of our next-gen children and parents to a baking party, and it's today at between 1 and 3 p.m. down in the gym. And so you'll get to bake cookies, decorate them, and then eat them. What could be better than that at Christmas time? So please let Kyrell know if you're planning on participating in that today. We also want to let you know about our Christmas cantata. Our FUMC Chancel Choir and Orchestra will be presenting their Christmas cantata next Sunday, December 19th, and it will be at both services, 8:30 and 10. They have been working very hard to prepare this joyful, spirit-filled music offering of the season. And so we encourage you to come, invite others to join you as well. And with all of this activity going on, as a reminder that Christmas is just about here, right? In 2 weeks, we will be celebrating Christmas. And we want to share with you our schedule for Christmas Eve services. We will have 3 in-person services this year. They'll also be live streamed, I believe, yes. And the first service will be at 6 o'clock in the evening, and it will be our modern music service. Our 8 o'clock service will be traditional music with our chancel choir. And the 11 o'clock service will be a lessons and carols type service with candlelight communion. And all of these services will end with candlelight and singing Silent Night. So we invite you to join us as we celebrate the birth of Christ on Christmas Eve. Well, during this season, as we have been lighting our Advent candles, we have been following a fictitious family who have been wrestling with the expectations that we place upon this time of year. And we also hear how the message of these candles invite us to experience the true gifts of the season. Let's watch.
You know, this season is hard. I mean, it's supposed to be full of joy and wonder and carols and cookies and all that, but sometimes it's not. I mean, sadness doesn't ever make the Christmas card.
I know. Grief has a way of showing up when you least expect it.
I was sitting here enjoying this coffee and thinking about our day, and I thought about my sister. I miss her so much.
Grief doesn't go away just because we're supposed to feel happy. It's also never truly gone. It just changes over time. And when it does come up, like right now, and it will, just let it be part of your experience. Joy and sorrow are never mutually exclusive. They go together, like peanut butter and jelly and salt and pepper.
Thanks. I guess love can lift you up and rip your heart out. Without it, I guess, life wouldn't be much worth it, though.
Will you stand and join me in song? Thank you.
Meanest state.
Before we go to our time of prayer this morning, we want to give you an update about the refugee family. As many of you may be aware, Pastor Steve and Becky Buchholz have been our liaison with those who are working to sponsor a refugee family here in Jefferson City. And we just received word this week that they are in the area and they hope to move into a house this Tuesday. So there's lots of needs that are still anticipated, and there'll be lots of opportunities for you to offer assistance. If you would like to be a part of providing some of that assistance, please let us know, and we'll keep you in the loop as we learn of opportunities. Also, financial gifts are appreciated as well, and so if you want to support this family through financial gifts that help meet needs that they have as they move here to Jefferson City, we invite you to do that. And you can do that through the church and just mark refugee family. So we want to hold this family up in prayer as they make this transition. It's been a difficult journey for them, one that many of us can't even begin to imagine. So we do lift them in prayer, and we're grateful for your support of them as they come into our community. So with that, would you join me now as we go to God in a time of prayer? Holy God, we are thankful for this time of year. We pause to recall how you came to us in Jesus, that Jesus is Emmanuel, God with us. We stand in holy wonder and awe. There is much about this time of year that brings peace and brings us joy. We also know that this time of year is hard, especially for those who are facing a significant loss or struggling with finances or even struggling to find a place of shelter. Because of your incarnation, you understand our grief and our pain. You do not think lightly of the suffering that many experience this time of year. And we also recall that it is your love that comes to us, your love that sustains us, your love that gives us hope. So we pray that your love will surround those who suffer this day and this season. We are especially mindful of those who suffered from the rash of tornadoes this past week, and we especially remember Mayfield, Kentucky. Surround those who have suffered great loss with your love and your hope. And we lift up prayers also for first responders and early responders who come to offer relief. May they be a means of your grace. And today we pray for our new refugee family. As they make this significant transition, we pray that in the midst of their grief and loss, that they find welcome in community. And we pray your blessing on those offering assistance to these families as they settle into a new home. We give thanks this weekend for new members and baptisms. What a gift to have those who join this church family. And we pray your blessing on them as they continue to grow in your grace and that we find community together. Gracious God, as we continue our Advent journey, enable us to focus on you and your love, and may our lives be grounded in you so that we may be your light in a hurting world. We pray all these things in the name of the one whose coming we anticipate, and we pray together as Jesus taught us with these words: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. Well, we have a children's time for us, and let us give our attention to Cairo.
Hey, everybody. So we're a week closer to Christmas, and so this week we're going to continue the story of learning about Jesus' birth. And this week, we're going to learn about Jesus' mother, Mary, and just learn a little bit about her before Jesus was actually born. The story we're going to look at today comes out of the book Luke from the Bible. And it starts off with an angel named Gabriel coming down from heaven to talk to Mary to let her know about the birth of Jesus. Greetings, Mary. I am the angel Gabriel, and I have been sent by the Lord. Do not be afraid, for you have found favor in the eyes of God. He has sent me to let you know that you will conceive a son by the power of the Holy Spirit, and you will name him Jesus. And your son will be a great man, and he will be called Son of the Most High, and the Lord God will put him on the throne of his ancestor David. Now, Mary was a little bit afraid, but she was also very confused about this message coming from the angel Gabriel. She didn't know how she was going to bear a son because she was only a virgin. But she trusted the angel because she trusted God. She told the angel that she's willing to do whatever God has for her because she trusts God and loves God. And after their conversation, the angel Gabriel left her. May God be with you, Mary. We can see here that God is setting Jesus up to be a miracle for the world. And it starts off with a miracle birth. But in order for this miracle to come into the world, Mary, just a regular old person, needs to trust and follow God and know that God can do impossible things when we believe in him. And so for us, we also need to remember that God can do miracles and impossible things through us if only we trust and believe and follow him. And with that, would you all pray with me? God, we thank you for this amazing story, the way that it shows how Mary was so willing to follow you and trust you, even when you're asking her to do something that seemed kind of scary or even impossible, God. And we just thank you so much for the miracle of Jesus and the way that Jesus came to be a miracle for the world so that you could be with us, so we could also do miraculous and sometimes seemingly impossible things with your help. We pray these things in your name, Jesus. Amen. And if you're with us in person today, we will be heading up to in-person Sunday school right after this. And if you're new today, parents, feel free to head up there along with your children just so you can get a chance to check out the space and kind of see what we're doing Sunday school. All right. Thank you. Bye.
All right. So it is time for those who are going to Sunday school. You can go now. Kyrell's over there by the door. And again, as always, parents, if you would like to go see the space where they're headed off to, you're invited to do that as well. Well, as they're making their way, I'd like to share with you our ministry spotlight today. And again, we're highlighting our giving tree. We're so grateful for the ways you have been generous already with our giving tree. And we are extending the time for the giving tree this year because there are so many things on there that particularly our Thorpe Gordon teachers have requested. And so we invite you to go on the app and look at the items that are still on the list. There's a few things on the tree, but most of the things are on our app. I'm always impressed that when we ask them for items for Christmas, for our giving tree, it's always things for their students, and so and simple things. So we invite you to be generous, as you already have, and if you would rather make a cash donation, we are, welcome you to do that as well. And again, just note giving tree on your giving, and we will give and bless those students and those teachers. Well, as we move to our offering time, again, we're grateful for your generosity in so many ways that enable us to bless our community, like Thorpe Gordon and Jefferson City Academic Center and our Fresh Start Market. You are a gift, and your giving makes a difference, not only in the lives of this congregation, but those that we serve beyond. So as we move to our offering today, it's a reminder of ways you can give an offering today. Those of you who are in the room, there's a basket back by the column there that you can place your offering now or after the service. You can give through our app, you can give online, or you can mail in a check. Let us worship God now in this time of offering. Would you join me in giving thanks to God for the gifts offered as we pray together? Holy One, this Advent season we wait with love and we give with love. Love for you, our God. Love for your beautiful people. Receive these generous offerings and use them for the work of your love in our world. Amen. Our scripture reading today is one of those pivotal passages for this time of year. And so will you hear these words from the Gospel of Matthew, chapter 1, verses 18 through 25. Now the birth of Jesus, the Messiah, took place in this way. When his mother Mary had been engaged to Joseph, but before they lived together, she was found to be with child from the Holy Spirit. Her husband, Joseph, being a righteous man and unwilling to expose her to public disgrace, planned to dismiss her quietly. But just when he had resolved to do this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary as your wife, for the child conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will bear a son, and you are to name him Jesus, for he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what had been spoken by the Lord through the prophet, "Look, the virgin shall conceive and bear a son, and they shall name him Emmanuel," which means God is with us. When Joseph awoke from sleep, he did as the angel of the Lord commanded him. He took her as his wife, but had no marital relations with her until she had borne a son, and he named him Jesus. This is the word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Thank you. Well, good morning. I'm Trevor Dancer. I'm lead pastor here at First United Methodist Church. I want to welcome all of you that are in the room and those of you watching on live stream. Today, I want to talk about a particular aspect of the Christmas story that maybe we don't often talk about enough. Here's a thought to begin with. I think maybe as a world, right? However generic and broad as you like to think of it, have forgotten how to deal with grief. Between natural disasters, political division, social media algorithms that drive you crazy, we've forgotten how to deal with grief. And the more we forget how to deal with grief, the more incapable we can seem to deal with redemption and reconciliation and resurrection. Because we've got our own stuff going on. We've got to know how to deal with that in order to move on with the rest. And today's story in our scripture passage reminds us that the Christmas story is not always rainbows and butterflies. It's not always happy Christmas carols and cookies. It's heartache. Joseph and Mary, in particular, in the Christmas story, had their lives turned upside down because of it. Mary alone, having to bear the Christ child, did an enormous amount of changes to her life, but so did Joseph. Joseph followed the normal social protocols of his day to be engaged. He was expecting it to go as normal as all the other engagements have gone before that he's witnessed. Except this one came with a hang-up, a wrench in the machine, if you will, and that is that she was discovered to be with child. And all the people in his social network had the same conclusion today as we would draw, that clearly something's amok. And in his protocol, in his day, he had every right to publicly dismiss Mary. And it would save his reputation, save his standing within the community. But scripture says he's a righteous man, so he doesn't want to do that. And the scriptures sort of tend to point that maybe it's because Joseph really is a righteous man and he doesn't want to do any harm to Mary. But it also might be possible that he just doesn't know how to deal with this. And so maybe dismissing her in quiet sort of minimizes the scandal. He can get ahead of it by dismissing her quietly and not have to deal with it. He can still get his golf tee at the country club at 8 a.m. that he's had for years. He doesn't have to worry about people giving him snarly looks at the office. If he does it quietly, maybe few people will know. And then he goes to sleep, and because that's what we do in times of stress, right? And he goes to sleep, and an angel comes to him, and then the angel helps confront him in his grief, helps him to name for him, perhaps, what he can't name for himself. And he says, stop what you're planning. This child is from the Holy Spirit. So continue on with the engagement. Become married to Mary. And he wakes up, and he has this moment of bewilderment, confusion, perhaps, and he may not know quite what to do. But he does something brave and courageous, I think. Here, he doesn't go around it. He doesn't go over it. He doesn't go under it. He goes through it. He decides that continuing on with the engagement is what God asked for him. But you have to confess, his picture-perfect idea of what this engagement might look like came crashing down real hard and real fast. He didn't know what to do with it. You see, grief and sorrow are dance partners with joy and peace. And any of us that have ever experienced grief, which I imagine is all of us, understand that all too well. That if you're going through a season of grief this time of year, this Christmas might be the first one where there's an empty seat at the table where there should be somebody. If you go through that year of first, there's whenever you get to their birthday and you want to call them and you realize that maybe you can't. Or even you reach over to grab your phone to text somebody something really funny and you realize, oh, they're not there on the other end. Grief does weird things. It conjures up memories that make you laugh and cry all together. I had a friend in college that his name was Charles, and he went by Bing for obvious reasons. And he had muscular dystrophy. And my rudimentary understanding of muscular dystrophy is that there's two sets of muscles in your body, and like, for instance, one that closes your hand and one that opens it. And muscular dystrophy says that one set of those deteriorates and doesn't generate. And it's a progressive disease. It's incurable at the moment, and it is indeed fatal, usually rather quick and young. He was diagnosed when he was 3, and the doctors told him that if he lived to be mid-20s, he would be a miracle. And he died, I believe, when he was turned 31. And part of the reason that he survived so long is because he was regimented in stretching. And this is critical if you have muscular dystrophy. You have to stretch your arms and legs. And one of the things we did when I would work with him is that we would go for a walk. And a walk looked like this, where I would stand him up, and he would sort of lean against my body, and he would put his hands on my arms, and then we would just sort of do like this little awkward dance thing, do it in circles. It was like we were slow dancing, really. And it would stretch his calves and thighs and so forth. And so one night we were at this Christmas party, and we were both kind of hungry. And so we were on our way back to his house, and we decided to stop at Steak and Shake at 11 o'clock at night. This was in my mid-20s. I don't know that I can do that now. But then I could. And it was just he and I, and then we had this other two dudes that were sitting at a table in the restaurant as well. And it got time for him that he needed to stretch. And so we stood up and we did the stretch in the middle of Steak and Shake, and we started slow dancing around in the middle of Steak and Shake at 11 o'clock at night. And as we made our turns, both of us kind of noticed that these other two people were kind of looking at us really strange and weird and like perplexed. And finally, and he was so quiet, I knew he would hate this, and so I did it. I looked, whenever I circled back and I saw them, I just kind of leaned over his shoulders talking to them, and I said, "Don't worry, I'm just teaching him to slow dance." And his face turned all red, as bright as this tablecloth. It was a funny moment. I could feel his nails going into my arms at the moment. And how I miss him. He would have turned 40 next year, died 8 years ago, almost 9 years ago. Grief does that to you. It conjures up memories. They make you happy and smile and sad at the same time. And in our culture, in this particular season, we sometimes are made to feel guilty if we don't feel all rainbows and butterflies on the inside. Sometimes we don't feel like playing songs while we're baking. Sometimes we feel like we just want to get past the season. Maybe we don't want to go to the office obligation party. Sometimes we feel like everyone's walking on eggshells, and maybe they don't know what to say, and so sometimes they say the wrong thing in an effort to try and say something. But if you're in that space, I want to say to you that all of our grief journeys are unique. There's never two alike. I like to think of it that as we go through our journeys of life, each of us are digging out our own maze of grief as we go along, and we go this way and we take a right, and eventually we end up at a dead spot, a dead end, and we have to turn back around and find a new way to go. And that is the way with grief. And if it was all the same, it'd be a lot easier. For some, it's not even grief over loss of a loved one. Sometimes it's grief over an estranged relationship or a tension in a really important relationship in your life that feels like it's on the verge of breaking and snapping apart, and you just don't know how to fix it. You don't know what to do. It's another kind of grief. I'm reminded of this passage in Romans 8:26. It's one of my favorite verses in the Bible. It says, "Likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weakness, for we do not know how to pray as we ought. But that very Spirit intercedes with sighs too deep for words." Some translations say that the Spirit intercedes with groans too deep for words. It's a moments. You have those? Where it's just wrong, something's off, you can't explain, it's hard to articulate. Somebody asks you what's wrong and you say, "I don't know." It's those groans that are just too deep. That's the Spirit interceding on your behalf. And I think maybe that's what the angel was doing with Joseph when he put him to sleep. Joseph didn't know how to comprehend it, didn't know what to do with it. He had groans too deep, and the Spirit interceded with him with a message from the angel. Sometimes we need those, and it's okay to not have all the right words. You know, and it's okay to create new traditions. It's okay to hold on to old traditions. It's okay to stay home. It's okay to go out. It's okay to not be okay at all. It's okay to be moving on. Wherever you are in your journey, it's okay. God is big enough to handle your grief, your complaint, your questions, your yelling, your finger pointing. God can take it all. And God is with you in the midst of it. One thing I will say to you is it's very important to share how you're feeling. It's important to share your emotions, what you're thinking, what's in your heart. The late and great Mr. Rogers once said this: anything that's human is mentionable, and anything that is mentionable can be manageable. When we can talk about our feelings, they become less overwhelming, less upsetting, and less scary. The people we trust with that important talk can help us to know that we are not alone. I love it. If you name it, sometimes those emotions have less power over you. They no longer manipulate you, no longer control you, but you have to be willing and vulnerable enough to share that with somebody else. It's a critical step as you navigate your own maze of grief, to be willing to share honestly. I remember years ago, I came across a man who was in his late 70s, early 80s, and he, about 15 years or so before I met him, he had a stroke, and so his right side of his body was severely disabled, and he had some mobility issues. And yet, he still kind of lumbered into our church one day, and after he was there about 4 or 5 months or so, he came up to me and said he'd like to visit with me sometime. And let me clue you in on that. When pastors hear that, we get a little nervous. The blood pressure rises. But I agreed to go over to his house one afternoon and just to visit with him. And he began to tell me about when he was a child, he experienced abuse. And he never told anybody that. He began to say that when he was in his late teens and early 20s, he fell into drug addiction and alcohol. And he says, those are my own choices, but I can't help but think that maybe my abuse helped make that bad decision for me a little easier to make. And it was obvious to me that he had been bearing this guilt and shame for whatever reason for 60 years. It's not uncommon to think that maybe it was not too dissimilar for him to be carrying a backpack full of rocks around for 60 years, slunching his body over, physically making a difference in his life. He began to tell me about how he just sort of feels like maybe that's what he deserved. And I told him, I said, I don't think that's how God works. See, I believe God wants you to live life freely and joyfully. I think God is not a mean kid on an anthill with a magnifying glass ready to smite you as the moment you make a mistake. Or I don't think he's sitting in a cloud with a lightning bolt ready to strike you down. I think God is a God of infinite love and mercy. And that's what the birth and death and resurrection of Jesus is all about. It's not about heaven and hell. It's about you living your best life, about serving God to the best of your ability and becoming all that God wants you to be. And God doesn't want you to hold around this bag of rocks for 60 years. So God has already forgiven you. You just have to forgive yourself. We were naming for him his grief. In the Eastern world, there's this concept called han. And han is, it doesn't have a great English translation to it, but the best way to think of it is han is as a wound to the soul, something that just scars you on the inside, that just stays with you, it changes you forever. The best way to think of it is the music genre, the blues. An African-American tradition in America where generations were enslaved, there's a wound to the soul to think that your grandparents or great-grandparents or even your parents were enslaved and treated as objects by people. And so han is going to be expressed in one way or the other, either creatively or destructively, either deadly or life-giving. And it will come out one way or the other. Those wounds on the soul do. In the music genre, the blues, is han expressed creatively. It was a musical expression to pour out what an entire generation of people have experienced. And for this man that afternoon, he was expressing his own han. He was pouring it out. And that's the trick with han. You have to do it collectively. You have to do it together, because otherwise you just become Han Solo. That one's for free. But something changed after he laid off his burden. He began to sit upright a little bit more. Color literally became back into his face, and a smile turned on his face that I hadn't seen before. As he stood up, he was able to walk even a little bit smoother. Held his shoulders and head a little higher. that he had actually laid it down. He had entrusted with somebody his grief and his journey, and he named it and was for the first time in 60 years able to let go of it. Now, I don't think grief is all that perfectly simple that you just drop it one time and you never have to think about it again, especially if you've been burying it for 60 years. But there's power in naming it, as Mr. Rogers says. You name it, it can be manageable. It can be less scary. So trust people with that important talk. I want to end with this. This is a quote from Anne Lamott. She says, "You will lose someone you can't live without, and your heart will be badly broken. And the bad news is that you never completely get over the loss of your beloved. But this is also the good news. They live in your broken heart that doesn't seal back up. And you come through it like having a broken leg that never heals perfectly, that still hurts when the weather gets cold. But you learn to dance with a limp." Friends, grief is a present reality for all of us. And grief is nothing more than the evidence of love. It's not the opposite of love. It's the side effect. It's the inevitability. When you pour out your heart and you offer it to somebody else, it'll happen. The more we name it, the more we can deal with it and recognize that even on one of the most holiest nights of the year on Christmas, the people that are in that story had to go through their own grief. And they trusted that God would be with them, would guide them and help them to learn to dance even with a limp. And it'll be beautiful nonetheless. Let's pray. God, we give you thanks for all that you are, for the ways that you love us beyond our comprehension. We give you thanks for the examples of Mary and Joseph, whose lives were turned upside down by you. They were forever changed by you. They suffered much in order to follow you. Lord, we don't take that lightly. But we give you thanks for their example of what it means to endure through the grief and the heartache and to find you on the other side. So does all of us deal with grief in our own way as we learn to navigate it in our own way? We ask that you be with us. Help us to not give up when we feel a dead end, to not be thrown back when grief sucker punches us, but to take it as it is, to deal with it, to name it, so that you can bring healing to it. And so I know that all of us walk away from life limping. None of us get out of this life unscathed. But let us pray that as we learn to dance together, as we dance with limping, and I pray that your Spirit would be upon us, that you would help us to communicate your unconditional love that knows no bounds. So it's in your name we pray. Amen. Today we get to experience, not at all, literally the opposite of grief, of pure and abundant joy. Today, a family that's been part of our church for a while has decided to join us, and they have two kids that we'll introduce to you in a minute, and we're going to get to baptize them, and we are excited. There's hardly a greater joy in life than being able to be a conduit for God's grace in your life, and so that's what we're going to do. So, Lenzini family, come on up. There we go. Thought I lost that. I needed that. All right. So, church, this is Amanda and Tabitha Lenzini. This is Kinley and Bodie, their children. And they came to our church, I don't know, I should have asked that before, 6 months ago, 5 months ago?
Sure.
Some time ago, they came to us, and they were part of Alpha Course and just dove in, and their kids are incredibly smart and wonderful and talented people. And so we're just excited to be a part of this offering and experience of God's grace upon them. So we have a liturgy that Karen and I will read, and some questions for you all and some questions for you as a congregation. But it begins this way. Dearly beloved, baptism is an outward and visible sign of the grace of Lord Jesus Christ, through which grace we become partakers of his righteousness and heirs to life eternal. Those receiving the sacrament are thereby marked as Christian disciples and initiated into the fellowship of Christ's holy church. Our Lord has expressly given to the little children a place among people of God, which holy privilege must not be denied them. Remember the words Lord Jesus Christ showed when he said, "Let children come to me, do not hinder them, for to such as these belongs to the kingdom of God."
And so I have a few questions to ask all of you. Do you, on behalf of the church, I ask you, do you renounce the spiritual forces of wickedness, reject the evil powers of this world, and repent of your sin? If so, say, "I do."
I do.
And do you accept the freedom and power God gives you to resist evil, injustice, and oppression in whatever forms they present themselves? If so, say, "I do."
I do.
And do you confess Jesus Christ as your Savior, put your whole trust in his grace, and promise to serve him as your Lord in union with the church, which Christ has opened to people of all ages, nations, and races? If so, say, "I do."
I do.
Right. To the congregation, I ask you this. Do you, as Christ's body, the church, reaffirm both your rejection of sin and your commitment to Christ? If so, say, "We do."
We do.
And will you nurture one another in Christian faith and life and include these persons now before you into your care? And your response is actually on the screen. With God's help, we will proclaim the good news. It will be, if not, I'll read it. We'll proclaim the good news and live according to the example of Christ. We will surround these persons with a community of love and forgiveness that they may grow in their trust of God and be found faithful in their service to others. We will pray for them that they may be true disciples who walk in the way that leads to life. In a moment, we're going to pour water and pray over it. And I told you that we're going to put some oil in it as a sign of the Spirit's presence with you. And you didn't get a chance to smell it. So here, I'll let you do this now. Watching your faces, because usually people either love it or hate it. One of the two. It's rarely in between. You love it? I do too. Knew I liked you. All right. Let us pray. Eternal God, your mighty acts of salvation have been made known through water, from the moving of your Spirit upon the waters of creation to the deliverance of your people through the flood and through the Red Sea. In the fullness of time, you sent Jesus, nurtured in the water of a womb, baptized by John and anointed by your Spirit. He called his disciples to share in the baptism of his death and resurrection and to make disciples of all nations. So pour out your Holy Spirit to bless this gift of water and those who receive it, to wash away their sin and clothe them in righteousness throughout their lives, that dying and being raised with Christ, they may share in the final victory through the same Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. So we're going to add just a little bit of oil here. I'm going to baptize you three times, pour water on your head. The idea of baptism is to get wet, right? When we talked about this and we knew they want to get baptized, we knew it would be mid-December. And so we thought, well, we have a way to do full submersion baptism. It better symbolizes the death and rising of Christ. And we have a way to do that out there. And then I thought, well, I can't recommend that because it's December. And then it turns out it's like spring right now. So who knows? So which one of you would like to go first? All right. I'll have you lean over this way. Bodie Lynn, here, dip your head down a little bit further. There we go. Bodie Lynn Zinni, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen. And Bodie, the Holy Spirit work within you that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus.
Amen. Congratulate him with me. All right, step just a bit. All right, ready? All right, Kinley Lenzini, you got to do the same thing a little further. It's not a pie. It's okay. All right, ready? Kinley Lenzini, I baptize you in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
And may the Holy Spirit work within you that having been born through water and the Spirit, you may live as a faithful disciple of Jesus.
All right. You congratulate her with me. All right, now this is the joining ritual for all of them. Amanda and Tabitha have already been baptized, in case you're wondering. So let me ask you a series of questions as well, and then Karen will ask to the congregation. These are joining questions. As members of Christ's universal church, will you do all in your power to strengthen the ministries of the church by your prayers, your presence, your gifts, your service, and your witness? If so, say I do. Do you commit yourselves to serve Christ in the world by working towards peace and justice? If so, say I do. And do you commit yourself to increasing the faith of others, confirming their hope and perfecting them in love? If so, say I do.
And friends of this congregation, we commend these persons to your love and care. Do all in your power to increase their faith and confirm their hope and perfect them in love. And let us join together in our welcoming greeting. As soon as it's on the screen, we give thanks for all that God has already given you, and we welcome you in Christian love. As members together with you in body of Christ and in the congregation of the United Methodist Church, we renew our covenant, faithfully participate in the ministries of the church by our prayers, our presence, our gifts, our service, and our witness. That in everything God may be glorified through Jesus Christ. Amen. Will you welcome this family with me? Right. After the service, I invite you to come up and say congratulations to them. So after when we get to the benediction, I'll ask you to come on up here, and then you can come up and greet them as you wish. Thank you. And Karen has given you baptism certificates. We have a shirt for the kids as well. And we'll give you these candles when they cool down. And so you can honor that. And I invite you, and I say this to all the families that have people baptized too. What's today? December 12th? 12th, December 12th. Every year on December 12th, treat it as sort of an anniversary, as a reminder of this day, to remind these two that on this day, the Spirit is placed powerfully in your life, so that no matter what happens in your life, no matter what age and phase you go through, nothing can separate you from the love of God ever. And I invite you to the congregation as you come up, and I invite you, if you've been baptized and you want to remember it, to come forward and just play in the water a little bit. You may dip your hand in it, you make a cross on your head or on your hand as you wish, and be reminded of your baptism, and to be reminded that no matter what you go through in life, nothing can ever separate you from the love of God. Amen. Will you stand as you're able, and let us sing our closing song.
Town of Bethlehem, how
us in worship today. May the grace and love of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ be with you this day and forevermore, and may you go in peace. Amen.